that were washed in her love. This is my story. This is my song. Praising the Spirit all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. I'm praising her. Who have joined me on the other side. First, my teachers, Mrs. Anna Julia Cooper and Mary Church Terrell, and the others who worked with me in the upliftment of women and our race. Mary McLeod Bethune, Ida B. Wells, Amy Jocks Garvey, Mary Murray Washington, Henrietta Benton Davis, Dorothy Height, and don't forget the brothers, the Honorable Marcus Garvey, Booker T. Washington, W.E.B. Du Bois, Adam Clayton Powell, John Hope, and others' names who we know and may not have called, we thank you for your service in social justice and the upliftment of our people. And to the President General of this esteemed government, his officers, and all of the members, I say thank you, thank you, thank you for having me journey here to share with you during the second mass meeting of the 53rd International Convention of the Universal Negro Improvement Association African Communities League. I love that name. I think some of you call it UNIA. I wonder if Brother Garvey knew that he had some key Swahili in there. We didn't speak key Swahili in my day. Thank you. It is my honor and privilege to share with you some words this evening. For those of you who don't know me, I am Miss, yes, I'm never married. I was married to my work, Miss Nannie Helen Burroughs. I was born in 1879, the daughter of two people who were born into slavery. My father was a Baptist minister who traveled around, and my mother was a professional in the domestic sciences. At the young age of 5, I was brought here to your fair city, Washington, D.C., so that I could have better opportunities and get a quality public education. During my day, the M Street School, now known as Dunbar High School, offered the pinnacle in higher education for Negro children in this land. And it is there that I learned much from Ms. Anna Julia Cooper, who now has a street, I understand, named after her in LaJoy Park, and from Ms. Mary Church Terrell. These two women were on the forefront of the battle line of lifting our young Negro women to their highest. And so after I graduated, I took heed and advice of my teacher, Mrs. Cooper. She always said, I am my sister's keeper. And so I moved to Louisville, Kentucky. And it is there, in the boarding house of women where I lived, that I began to hold evening classes for the women of that house. We formed the Women's Industrial Club, which was highly respected by both white and colored people. These classes I taught included bookkeeping, secretarial courses, sewing, evangelism, stenography, housekeeping, and other things that women of the time needed to know. We made our money by selling lunches to the laborers for 5 cents. We did very well. But after a time, I realized that I needed to return to Washington, D.C., because in this city were black women migrating from all over the nation and the Caribbean. Why? Because of the opportunities to work in the homes of high government officials and congressmen. I came here, and as a good Baptist woman would do, I approached the National Baptist Convention seeking financial assistance from these men. Well, I was flatly refused. But I was not discouraged. I took it upon myself to reach out to women all over this country. And it is through many small contributions from many low-income women and some major contributions from private donors that I was able to open my school in 1907, debt-free. Ms. Maggie Lena Walker, who was the first woman president of any bank, who just so happened to be a Negro, gave me half of my down payment for the property that I purchased on a hill here in Washington at 50th and Grant Streets Northeast. I am forever in her debt. I'd like to tell you a quick short story about raising money. At my time, Mr. John D. Rockefeller was the wealthiest man in this nation. And so I took it upon myself to write him a letter asking for funds. He sent me $1 and asked me how I would invest that money. I wrote him back, and I told him I would buy peanuts, shell them and roast them, and return them to him in a bag, asking him to autograph each one, mail them back to me, and I would sell them for $1 each. He must have thought I was pretty enterprising because he did offer financial assistance. So, it has been my life story to do many, many things. Not only in the women's and suffrage movement of this country, but most importantly, in the movement of our race of people. I am very, very grateful that the school I founded, the National Trade and Professional School, still exists to this day. However, it is now named the Nannie Helen Merrill School. And so 50 years after my death, and 100 years after the founding of this school, I can still say my legacy lives on.